Hi, welcome to Overlooked. My name is Pooja Advani. My guest today is Mumbai's super vet. She's been working with various welfare organization and animal rights groups such as RAWW, TSPCA, as well as PETA. A leading expert in pain management and various other therapies, she is Dr. Deepa Katyal. Hi, doctor. It is a pleasure to have you here today.
Thank you so much.
As we always begin with, I would actually like to know what actually led you to be a veterinarian?
I think I was just designed or karmically come here to become a veterinarian and nothing else. They say that past karmas, you've done something so horrible to those animals that you need to now, you know, sudharify your karmas and get even with whatever evil you've done to them in the past. I think that's what I've come here for. And basically, yeah, I think this is just a calling. I couldn't have done anything else, you know.
So what was that one key factor that turned around and told you that I am going to dedicate my life being a veterinarian or saving animals?
See, I grew up in a family which was a business family, and my dad, I grew up with animals. My dad, Mr. Pran Katyal, he's the most dearest soul to me on, of course, he's passed away, but he's still so dear to me. And I think his genes are what prevail in me, and the compassion that comes from my mother, and his love for animals. So when I was born, we had dogs at home, and my first Rakhi brother was actually not my real brother, but I used to tie Rakhi to my dog because that's the closeness I found myself growing up with. Obviously when you were growing up with animals, you understand that these are something different and not humans. And the likeness towards them just happens because when I believe so much in karma, and I say that, you know, they attract you to so much extent. And I think I was a very little girl, and obviously with the dogs, cats, ducklings, and whatever we had
at home. So you had a whole range of
them. Absolutely, birds and everything at home. So every Sunday morning, it was Dad's day to get the ticks off the dog, bathe them, and we always had more than one dog in the house at a time. And so it was like a chore, you know. And for me, it was the most exciting day of my week, where I would sit with Dad and get the ticks off, you know, have the bowl of kerosene nail, you know, earlier days. I was blessed. We were in a bungalow, and both of us were actually doing our thing. And suddenly we heard like a pack of crows that came in to the house. And we heard this cacophony and commotion, and Dad goes into the garden, and we find this little bird stuck, you know, she was entwined with a fledgling in to one end of the string. Dad released the string, and the mother bird just flew away, and we had this like baby fledgling which was in our hand, which, you know, had barely opened its eyes and had not even his primary feathers come in, basically a naked fledgling bird. And Dad was like, you know, we need to make like a nest for it. And he just like very naturally just got some cotton and put the baby bird there. And I don't exactly remember what he fed, but I'm very sure there was some milk and bread, which obviously we don't encourage anymore. But those were the days, and whatever was feasible for people's knowledge. And he actually started feeding the bird, and I kept seeing that, and, you know, I said, you know, Dad, let me just take over this bird. And I was so little, he said, no, you'll kill it. You don't know how to deal with it. And I said, no, you just give me the bird. I'm going to take care of it. And it became like my baby. So at that age, when you possess something.
How old were you, if you don't mind me
asking? I think I was anywhere between 6 to 8. I'm not really very sure about the age, but I think about 8 years. And that bird was my possession, and I treasured, we called her Myra, and I treasured that baby fledgling to my life. And I gave up my toys, I gave up my friends, and I remember my best friend would come knocking after school, and she would like, you know, come out to play. I said, no, I have to spend time with Myra. She's growing up. I have to be her mother. And you know how children are. So anybody and everybody knew that, you know, I'm always with her. And I just took on to the bird so much that she became like my soul. And I would come from school and just feed Myra and be with Myra. And Myra started growing. And because of that accident where the string was attached to her legs, I think she had a fracture and she couldn't walk properly. So she would limp and she would follow me around everywhere. And you know how humans are, I always feel we are so selfish that we always want to be important. So I was the most important thing in Myra's life, and that made me feel very happy. Also the love and affection that that animal gives you, you know. She would come cuddle up to me, and I was so aware when I used to sleep, that so conscious of her being with me, that I wouldn't sleep well because the bird used to always be sleeping with me, and so conscious of not being able to hurt her as a child. See, if an adult does it, it's a different thing, but a child doing it, I think that's where I started developing the love and affection. And I still remember Myra had really started growing up. She would fly a little, and it was almost like I think one of those days I came back, and it was a horrible day of my life. But I think also there's something hidden under the carpet when you do something which is disastrous, but it actually leads you to a path. And I came back home, and I was, you know, just put my bags down and just started searching for the bird. I didn't realize the bird had jumped out of the nest to come to me because she heard my voice. And inadvertently, I stamped on the bird. And the bird got crushed in front of my eyes with my own legs. And I killed the bird. So it was like the most horrible day of my life.
I can imagine.
I don't know
as
how it was.
As an 8 year old.
Yeah, and it just broke me up. Completely disastrous day of my life. And I called my dad up. He was at work. And I told him, and my dad's factory was in Baikal at that time. And I called my mom. My mom was a working person. I called her from the factory. I called my dad from the factory. And I'm like, get me this bird back. And I was like a intractable child, just wouldn't want to listen. And I want that bird alive back again. My mom tried to console me, my dad tried to console me, and it was a situation I don't think that they could handle. And I just gave up eating food, and I would do nothing else but cry. And for a child like this, you know, to be like this, they were really, really worried about me. So much emotion. And my dad actually thought, you know, this is not the right place for me to be with being so emotional. So they tried to take me out, you know, make me understand that the bird has gone to a better place. You know how parents try to
protect
and motivate you and your interests. But yeah, I just wouldn't listen. But that moment in which Dad held the bird in the hand, he made me look at the bird and he said, see, she's gone. We have to give her a burial. And you have to understand that this is not the last animal that is going to come into your life. There are going to be many more. If you're going to behave like this, I will never ever get you another animal. And then I just, you know, for some time, like a very filmy thing that when you talk about it right now, but I held the dead bird in my hand, and somewhere in my life, I just promised to myself and I said, this is it. You know, this is where I'm going to go. And if ever I want to do anything in my life, it's going to be around animals. And I don't want to see another dying animal in my hand. And somewhere I pledged to myself and my soul that I am going to be a veterinarian. Because I used to see a vet come to my house to help my dogs. And but this was like my inner bond with me. And that was it.
That's amazing. That's I think each one of us has that
absolutely
one key factor which it becomes your driving force to make you do what you want to do. Yeah. Your most iconic cases that I've actually read about is Lucky and Babulal.
Yeah.
Would you elaborate on how you found them and how were they released back to the wild, nursed and released back to the wild?
So it's a journey, you know. It's an amazing, amazing journey. When I look back to my life, the first primate I ever rescued was when I was doing my bachelor's in Parel. in the year 93, 94. And I was traveling by the BSC 90 limited bus to go to my college. And I was at Science Circle, and I very clearly remember I'm sitting on the bus and I see these madaris with a small baby monkey, and they're feeding, they were throwing biscuits, and a feral dog or a street dog comes in and tries to grab the biscuit, and the baby monkey is, and you know, these people, their attention is just diverted, and the monkey tries to take the biscuit from the dog's hand, and the dog bites his hand off. And I see like a pool of blood in a fraction of seconds, and it was an instinct. I just ran out of a jumping bus, you know, leaving my bag behind in the bus, and I know it was like such a chaotic situation in my head just to go and save that animal. I went there and I told them, listen, I'm a veterinarian. I've just started my practice. This was, yeah, it was in 97 because that's the day I began my practice and I had my clinic. So I told them I have a clinic. I'm going to go and help you to save this animal's arm because it's bleeding very badly. It'll die. I called up my surgeon friend and made him leave college, come to the clinic and do a surgery on this little baby monkey. I think the monkey must be hardly around 25 days old.
Roughly. That small?
Yeah. And his name was, I called him Babuli. And it was so funny that after we finished the surgery, when I came out, the madaris were not there. And I'm stuck with this primate and I don't know what to do but to take him home. And I go home and everybody is just like, what is this? Like, they couldn't even make out what is in my hand. And my mom was like, are you crazy? Are you going to keep a monkey? And I'm like, I don't know what to do with it. This is in my hand. It's completely bad right now. I need to take care. And my dad was overwhelmed, happy as he can be because there was a baby monkey in the house. And yeah, so a lot of care, lot of comfort, lot of pain management, with knowing no knowledge and doing whatever we could, that damn monkey with that luck survived. And we called him Babuli. So he was with me for several years. And post that, the PFA, Dharmesh Solanki was a friend of mine who used to work as a trustee in PFA. They rescued another monkey on Holi Day, who was rescued from a hotel in Bhiwandi. She was kept in a very small monkey, very small cage, and she had to compete with rats for food. And this monkey was suffering from a condition which I learned later on in my lifetime, from self-infliction behavior, because monkeys are very smart. And when they are very little and they're kept in a cage, they start inflicting themselves. And probably she had to compete with these rats who would probably bite her also sometimes. So we rescued Holika. I mean, I called her Holika because we rescued her on a holy day. We got her home. And then I made this huge enclosure in my house, which was 13 by 9 foot. And I kept it outside my garden in the bungalow. And with these two primates inside. This was in the year 97. And I saw myself understanding behavior, studying things about primates and looking at both these animals. It was a whole new vision that was there in front of me. So apart from my dogs and cats, these were animals that I kept looking at and studying their behavior in captivity, obviously.
Right.
Because these are animals that are so close to human beings at that point of time. And I was just taking care of them. And Babuli had one hand because obviously I had amputated, and the other one had a mental problem, which is called self-infliction behavior. So I got a complete, and the baby stayed with me for quite some time, and they died because of several other factors. But yeah, and that was my first step into working with primates. They're always considered as pests over here in our city, and they're often thrown acid on. They get electrocuted because of the live wires that we have, and so on and so forth, because these animals are not important to us economically. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I get what you're saying.
But the thing was that this is an animal that's in pain, trauma, and probably suffering the most because there are madaris that are using them to earn money. So, you know, they're getting them to urban to our cities, keeping them captive, and when they become difficult to control because they are, after all, wild animals, they're just abandoned in the city. So then on, there were these two primates that were rescued, one after the other. One was Babulal, one was Lucky. That was the first primate that came in completely burnt and charred. And it took me, and that was my first year in my board as a director for pain management. And I had all the support from Mary Ellen Goldberg. She's one of my dearest friends overseas. And she does a lot of work for pain management. She's a veterinary technician. And it's amazing the kind of information she has. And then I had the good fortune of meeting Stephen Seitel, who's actually writing a book on pain management with reptiles and primates. So they were the first people who actually told me, you know, do this, do that, do this, do that, don't do this, do that. And, you know, handling different drugs. Because imagine your little finger getting burned as against the whole body getting burned. How difficult it is for you to survive from that infection, from that pain, and continuously, you know, this poor animals. Because what happens is these babies are actually holding on to their moms. The moms get electrocuted, and this is such high voltage that the babies actually fall down, and their entire abdominal or front portion, you know, the ventral surface gets burned, including their private parts, including the orifices from where they defecate and urinate. And it's appalling because, you know, it's burnt, and on top of that, there's urine trickling down from there, which is warm, and it's so painful. And this monkey, I captured some videos because I had to give a pain talk somewhere. He couldn't even hold an apple in his hand. You know, he wanted to hold the apple after the pain management was done, and he used to get pain relief, and he couldn't hold the apple in his hand, and it was heartbreaking to see all those things. And then I decided, I said, we have to do something for these animals. Though they are not economically important, but they are suffering, and nobody deserves to have this pain and suffering. So yeah, that was it. And then came in Babulal with the same kind of thing. And then we had Choti, who's not very popular, but Choti is one of the dearest souls on earth. She has an amazing story to herself. She was a 23-year-old baby monkey that was rescued from Alibag by a rescuer called Hakim Sheikh. He's an amazing guy because he does all these big monkey rescues, and nobody wants to put their hand inside because monkey rescues can actually help have you get into huge kind of accidents because they bite, and their bites are potentially very unsafe. So it seems that there were two big monkeys that were fighting with each other territorially. And this little baby monkey was with the mother. You know how males are, two egos clashing. And the male was so busted, the one who got defeated, was so busted with anger that he just yanked this baby monkey, started biting her out of nowhere, and bit her hand, bit her leg, bit her on the neck, and swung her around so much so that she fell into the nearby, there was a lake over there. She fell there, and this guy who was a rescuer was seeing the entire situation around. He rescued her, called me up at 1 a.m. in the morning, and he said, you know what, this is a bad case. I need you to come and see this monkey or she's going to die. And when it's a monkey, nothing stops me. And I just ran and I went to work, and that was the most painful thing that I had ever seen. Fortunately, internationally, America was actually having day, and I called up my friends, and they were on the phone with me, and we were working on her pain management and everything. And then eventually, she ran into gangrene with that hand, which was actually bitten, because this was a through and through wound. You could see her bone. And I had to work very quickly because her hemoglobin was falling down. She was getting septic. And the only thing my friend said was, have somebody do the surgery quickly. And somehow you had to finish the surgery quickly so that you can reverse the animal. And we had no reversals. Fortunately, I had packed everything for a bird surgery, and I had gotten to Bombay. But everything worked around miracles for this little child. And we got the surgery done. I had a human orthopedic guy, a pediatrician, who came and did the surgery for me in less than 15 minutes. We had a hand amputation done. And she was under cold laser. Everything that in the universe was working around this little kid. And we could give her the best. And it was amazing because in 45 minutes post-surgery, she was eating her first meal. And that was her story of survival. And right now, she is rehabbing with another baby monkey in Kalote. So this is something that we wanted to venture on. And I wanted to do is monkey rehab.
Hmm.
Because we were not getting support from anywhere. And I was really very concerned about where these monkeys went post I treating them.
Hmm.
So, you know, you put in so much of your energies. And I don't only work as a veterinarian in the clinic, managing them medically, but my services are extended at home as a mother to them, fostering them, you know, getting them off this whole thing. So it's a never ending. It's like a continuous attachment. Like, how would you do it to a child?
Hmm.
So then after that, once you've done it and you consciously know that this animal cannot be released back into the wild, what are you going to do with them? Where are you going to keep them? I can't keep gathering monkeys in the place where I stay. You know, we have so many other commitments that we have. And plus, if I keep my rooms full, where will I get room for another animal to come in for me to treat them?
Right.
So this was a serious trauma in my head, just very serious. And every time I think about it, I also know that every night I slept with Babuli and Holika, this was a fear I had. Unfortunately, fortunately, they died with me. But I used to always feel, tomorrow if I get married, this was my earlier days, where am I going to keep these monkeys? But today, for another Deepa that's in making maybe, both me and a very close friend of mine, Samir Vora, who's the founder of Kalote Animal Trust, we decided to start a monkey rehabilitation center.
Hmm.
And we were actually encouraged by the wildlife department, and they said, you know, it's really good. We don't have any such place right now. And if you guys want to get into this, we can support you. And so Kalote, where we have these monkey cages, we are trying to make them as spacious and as modern and as technically good as they are in the Western countries. So I don't care if they are not economically important. For me, I don't even care if they are not environmentally important, which I don't think is true.
Okay.
But a lot of people tell us, you know, these are just pests. They just keep multiplying. They just, you know, we hear stories of people culling those animals, just like dogs in so many states. But for me, every animal that's in discomfort and in pain is important. And just as you would be compassionate to a human child who's in pain and suffering, for me, that is a life that I need to take care of, be it a reptile, be it a monkey. But yeah, this is something that we are committed to doing in the next 1 or 2 years, is making a foster or a rehabilitation center for many, many more monkeys that cannot be released into the wild. So we have maimed, we have blind monkeys over there.
Hmm.
We have babies, baby monkeys which are hand-raised and cannot be released because there is an international guideline that says that you cannot release baby monkeys that are hand-raised by humans because they won't know how to survive.
Hmm.
So we are working around international modules right now and getting more knowledge. We've had a Canadian veterinarian who works with wildlife and primates came and interned with us at Kalote. So, you know, I am trying to be at the top of it as much as I can for getting a structured, a politically correct structured stuff for our primates here.
So you do various amount of therapies. You do cold laser, you do acupuncture, physio, hydro. What are the cases that will... Firstly, tell us what are these various therapies and what are the cases that will probably be used for these therapies?
So since I went on board, and obviously I have to talk about dogs and cats because that's where my money comes from to support the other lovely things that I want to do in life. But yeah, so dogs and cats, majorly old age, like geriatric cases that we get, they're generally having osteoarthritis, primarily hip dysplasia, which is obviously a bad breeding disease that is almost there. If I may have been bold enough to say, it's about 80% of cases that we see with our retrievers, Great Danes, Saint Bernards, and all these fancy breeds that we can think about. So if these breeds are going to exist the way they are with the bad breeding that we have, we are going to continue seeing our animals in pain and suffering, because as they age, the floorings are so bad that we stay in, and they require therapies to basically be stable. So sometimes, I'm not talking about extreme cases of paralysis where they are neurological or they have spinal traumas or accident cases. I'm talking about just being normally bad bred animals and going through paralysis because of bad breeding, you know.
Yeah. I want to understand, over the last maybe 10 years, say 5 years, have you seen the cases that you're seeing increase in probably obesity, hip dysplasia, other kind of neurological conditions, or any other hereditary conditions that they have? Has that kind of skyrocketed over the last couple of years because of bad breeding or maybe even ignorance?
See, I'll give you a small story here, which is self-explanatory actually. So I have a clinic in a particular area, and there used to be a vegetable vendor outside my clinic. One day he comes to my clinic and he says, "Mere paas Labrador ke Labra ka bachcha hai. Kisko chahiye hoga to bolna, main 5,000 mein de raha hoon." And I'm like, "Kya?" You know, this is a vegetable vendor. Comes and tells me this.
You know, I think each one of us has got calls like that at some point.
He went out there and saw him. Along with the vegetables, he had this like basket in which he had this 6 puppies, Labrador Retriever puppies. Does he know about breeding, bad breeding, genes, hip dysplasia? He has no knowledge. He just bought together 2 Labrador looking like dogs.
Labrador looking like
God
dogs.
God knows what. But he was like very happy to tell me that he had Labrador Retrievers and he was selling them for $5,000. So this is your breeding industry in India. And this is how people buy dogs. Like, taste the truth. You know? So if I'm completely thinking about backyard breeders, where are they even coming into question? Because people are going to buy these dogs from these kind of people who are selling them so cheap. Yes, people who are aware, it's a different story, but even they get conned. Don't go far. It's me. I had a boxer which was so-called bred for type and temperament years ago. My dad was into this crazy shit of, but he was into this thing, "I want a German Shepherd and I want a boxer." But he was good enough. He would take in the streets also, society street animals also when it was raining and everybody was given shelter. But you know how it is, like people with me, like my own dad, was so fond of pedigree dogs because they look majestic, you know. So I got in a boxer, and the guy was a cryptocid. A monocid. He had only one testicle. And imagine where.
But you know what? Sorry to cut you. I have come across, like at Doggy Dog World right now, I have a few boxers. And that somehow has becoming a genetic condition.
Yes, yeah. So it is.
So it is so funny. In the last, I've been doing this now for almost 9 years. But I never saw so many. Right now, I have about 5 boxers as clients. all of them have this condition?
Yeah, so you know, it's awareness. It's also more awareness. Because we are aware of bad breathing now. And the first thing that our client comes to us for examination is we check those things and we inform them. And yes, if you are telling me this and I'm actually thinking about it, a lot of these genetic diseases are because I deal with the paralyzed and hip cases, I see so many of them, you know. So obviously, I'm going to say that in the past 4 years, there's been a marked increase in the number of cases that are coming to me with pain and trauma or hip dysplasia or arthritis or spondylosis, you know, all these kind of problems. Which
but it
are
can
genetic.
Be from, it can be both ways, right? One, because you deal with it.
Yeah.
I think there's
also awareness.
That's what I was coming to. There are multiple factors to it that probably you are getting that many cases.
Yeah.
Which could be awareness, that people are becoming more aware of what's actually going on. The second factor will be probably because you specialize in the field, you are getting those cases.
Yeah.
And the third factor could be that there's an increase in the number.
Absolutely. See, I'll tell you what, Pooja, it's not only about everything is in sync right now, because you know what, breeders, no matter how much you try to explain it to them, will never ever want to say that they have bred the dog badly. Okay, and there is no structured thing to do a hip score that is there, which is an international guideline. And look at we have like about 60 odd dogs in Kalote, and I think 10 or 15 of them are animals that have been abandoned because of bad bone structure. Because they have these fancy Bernards and Mastiffs and, you know, whatnot that they get. And then those dogs can't walk or make, or even, you know, even sit and stand properly in a smooth flooring. And those dogs are just later on wanting to be abandoned because people don't know how to deal with that situation. And they don't want to spend that time to deal. I'm sure you're in this thing. You must be meeting all kinds of people. There are such dedicated people that you feel, oh my God, this is like beyond.
So I have seen, I see them to the two extremes of the spectrum.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So you see one spectrum, one entire group of people that are totally committed, completely committed. And then you see another group of people who basically do not have any idea of what they're doing. And yes, it amazes me. And for us, we are very limited to say what we can actually say. So it just comes down to...
Absolutely. So even as if you're feeling as a therapist, you are limited. We as veterinarians are very limited, because it's so amazing that I say that the breeders are the first one to influence the parents' mind.
They're the first contact, no? So I always say that all of us are like I am at the last end of the spectrum. It's the breeders, it's then the pet shop owners, it's then the veterinarians, and then it is us. You know, we as boarding, grooming, therapy centers, we are like right at the bottom. By then, the entire range of things have already been done.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So for us to even come out and say anything which is opinionated actually doesn't matter.
So that's what I'm saying. Can you believe like a veterinarian saying this, that we are not even, sometimes we are not even considered, because we are considered to be doing this only because we want to make money out of the dog. So it's so sad. The whole concept is so sad. But yeah, and bad breeding, say the most important thing beyond all this dysplasia, beyond all this obesity, is not only lifestyle. It's bad breeding.
Oh, really?
Okay. Because there are genes that are carried forth. You see soft palates in pugs. How bad is that? I mean, these people are creating... My heart goes out to those dogs. You know, pugs are one breed I really, really feel bad about. And the way people lack the knowledge of soft palates, that they don't know, they feel that the dog is snoring, which is like a common thing for the dog to snore. My dog, but the breeder said that it's normal. The not informed vet said it's normal. And then when we actually give them a handout that your dog is actually having a brachycephalic syndrome, and not snoring because he's supposed to snore. No dog on earth is supposed to snore. there is a problem in your animal. There's a surgery that is to be done in the animal to correct that so that he doesn't get laryngeal paralysis later on in life. So many people are not even aware and they're buying those breeds. And it's so, so, so sad.
So moving to the cases that we are seeing in wildlife. And I mean, before I move to wildlife, I want to talk to you about cruelty towards animals. And I'm sure you will be seeing quite a number. And I mean, according to me, abandonment is cruelty. All these aspects, even if you have a pet and you don't have time for them, that is cruelty. Why do you see a rise in the cruelty cases? Are we becoming so inhumane, or are we getting so stuck in the structure of things that we forget that they are a living species?
Yeah, so I don't know, like when we bring up this topic, a lot of people say, oh my God, you know, there's so many human beings that are getting affected. There's so many child rapes that are happening, and all you can see is cruelty in animals and, you know, standing up to animal rights and so on and so forth. And it's pretty interesting because I'll tell you what, in my mind, it was always there. It was under the carpet.
Always.
We've not had any
industry that does not use animals for something.
Right from bestiality, right from the slaughterhouses, how these animal poultry, dogs and cats, exotic animal breeding, everything, every minute we breathe, there is an animal subjected to cruelty. Now, our awareness is at its peak. That's what we are. When I started off, I remember we were a handful of people who were doing animal rights in the city. Just a handful of them. Today, you see how many NGOs you are calling. You're at your inviting them to speak to. So, if cruelty has increased, so have the number of people who are actually trying to save them. And it's amazing because the kind of work that you see and the exposure that we have to media right now, and we are seeing, if there's cruelty happening in a society against dogs, there are 10 people who are uniting. See the WhatsApp groups that are there, the animal rights groups that are there. I don't even know how many number of them have pulled me in as a participant. And it's amazing. So, for whatever reason they are working for or whatever it is, I feel that this topic is something that is beyond reach now. Because there's so much happening everywhere, worldwide, as we talk, and to another level. Like when I started doing primate work and research, I knew that there is bestiality happening to a level that you can't even think of to these primates.
Yes.
And I was shaken, my soul was shaken.
I mean, so, we have orangutan brothels in Indonesia.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. Do you know that? I mean, you're aware of it. So that's what we are talking about. And there is so much of rise of cruelty also because people want to get a kick out of being popular. Like that thing in which they put a rod in a monkey somewhere, you know?
Yes, yes.
I'm sorry, I'm bringing up primates is something that so hard hitting.
Those are those medical students.
Exactly.
Right?
You know, it's infamously famous.
Yes, it is.
So, if somebody can be so atrociously bad and at that level of cruelty to humans, to animals, where is the world going into frustration? But at the same time, there is a hope because people like you, people like me, people like so many others have joined hands politically together in, you know, or not together, but they're still in their own way, trying to help animals. That's the beauty of it. That I look at it like that because every day you open the Facebook or you open some space where you're looking at the animal news and there's so much sinking feeling when you see what is happening to these animals, you know. But at the same time, you have so many other videos where people are saving paralyzed dogs, taking an animal out of a dungeon or whatever pit that has fallen down all over, you know. In Kerala, you heard about the dog massacre. you know, that how that was happening. And then I read some news where this a bull was had fallen down and how they took 4 hours to get the bull out. So everywhere, because of the equilibrium that we are trying to maintain with the good souls and the bad souls, or the good karma and the bad karma that we have, is how we are living now. And it's horrible for us as we speak, because like I said, every breath that we are taking, some animal is dying of cruelty.
Yes.
And every breath we are taking, somebody is saving a life. Maybe the other one is more higher than the saving bit of it. But I'm sure at some time, if people like you who are spreading this awareness through this, you thought about it, right? So that's in itself is incredible. Because I'm sure the people who are going to see this are going to realize the importance, and somewhere this thing is going to touch their space. So maybe some young Deepa, 8-year-old Deepa, who would probably see this with her parent, or somebody else, a Pooja who's seeing this with her parent, is in the making, right?
Right.
So I'm sure like wonderful people will breed wonderful things. So that's what we have to hope for.
How do we inculcate awareness towards in our children? How do we inculcate this about cruelty? And I mean, because you have to sensitize it, right? Some levels you have to kind of filter it out. How do we inculcate compassion, empathy in our children? How do you teach them that coexistence, conservation is an important aspect for our survival today?
It's a very interesting topic, and it has to really, really be researched on in the correct way. But I think the most important thing is documentation and like film, you know, actually showing them what is right and what is wrong. I don't think I gave a TED talk on pain management about a year back in Delhi. This was in a school. And after I gave the TED talk, I was surprised. You know, in one of my videos, I showed how they hold the murgis, the chickens, upside down. And, you know, so many times when I cross that particular area, Chembur Naka, there are these chicken shops, and they're always doing that. In my earlier days, I would get down, fight with them, and I have actually been hit. And obviously, I want to live, so I left doing all that. Now I just shut my eyes and I walk through. And so many of us are just doing that. So this little kid comes up to me and asks me, you know, I see this all the time. How do I stop it? It was just imprinted in his head, and he kept asking me that, and I had no answer for it.
Hey, that's the thing. How do you teach them that this is wrong? And like you said, you got assaulted, and you said, I'm not going
to
do it.
I have to live.
I have to live, exactly. Yeah. But how do you put that stop there?
It's.
I mean, you brought this up. I saw it right now while coming here for the show.
But that's what I'm saying. How many of us use glue traps? Like basic training. But that's what I'm saying. The most important thing for us is to start, you know, like schools are basically important. They are a place to reach out with the NGOs. A lot of these NGOs are doing, the proactive ones are doing lectures on poisonous snakes, non-poisonous snakes, and rabies awareness. And this was happening in those earlier years of our lives also. And I think now the kids have become so strong that even if you show them a movie of cruelty of like a slaughter, vegetarianism, I just touched it briefly, and a child at Delhi came and told me, you know, doctor, even I became a vegetarian. Like, which part and whom are you sensitizing to with what you don't know?
No.
But I think the important part is, and this is not, it just doesn't stop at a conversation. I, in person, don't have children because I chose not to have human babies because I know that I cannot share my love with a human child. And very conscious decision taken at a very young age. Fortunately, I found a partner to support that. It's not an easy decision to take, but I did do it. And then I always ask my friends on my WhatsApp group, my school colleagues who are actually have children. And then they say, you know, all my kids, that they keep seeing your monkey videos and they pray for your monkey. So even like showing them videos like this is sensitizing them. So this is surreal, okay, where we think, we envision that you're going to have only human beings that are compassionate. That doesn't happen because upbringing is everything. There are so many people who don't like animals themselves. And what are they going to inculcate in their children? The same thing, right?
See, don't liking animals is one aspect to it.
No, but...
Not liking and then harming them or think if you can harm them, that's one other aspect.
That's what I was trying to come up to. So there are people who don't like them and they would say, like, even if the child is touching a dog or a cat who's getting wet, they would say, chi-chi-chi. You know, it's so instinct. I don't like chi-chi-chi. I'm not doing anything wrong to it. But I'm not allowing you to pick it up. That's the end. Because I don't like it. So if I don't like it, but I allow the child to pick it up and keep the animal sheltered or even if it's raining, that's not stopping or impeding that action of that child. You know what I mean?
Yes.
So I'm not being cruel. I'm just asking you not to touch. But those emotions go far in a child. So, I think also animal laws should be inculcated as, and cruelty should be a part of studies in our curriculum. I think it's so important to start with something like that. Because maybe if I was exposed to something like that, it would have made me, see, obviously I take it as a calling, so it was going to happen to me one day or the other. You know, it's your calling. It would have happened to you one day or the
right.
other. But if it's not my calling and I'm going to be a Ratan Tata tomorrow, and I have been, probably he was sensitized to it. That's why he's so sensitive about it. But I'm just saying, like, or a Bill Gates or whoever, you know,
right.
one of these rich guys that you have here who are influential. And probably if it was a part of their studies to be sensitive to animals, they would have... So many people would have been different individuals because you don't know which chord you're striking at that age.
Right.
So I think it's to begin with that. It's very important. And then how you conceive and perceive it after your schooling, you know, if you've been sensitive to it or actually exposed to it is most important. Because most of our kids are not even exposed to it. They see this day in and day out and they don't even know whether it's right or wrong. They think that it's supposed to be done like this. A chicken is supposed to be held like this because nobody tells them what is right. And they're seeing it all the time and nobody is objecting to it. So if you go to the depth of it, I think it's extremely important to make them sensitive at that age if it is a part of their education.
Right.
So somewhere you have to tweak the system, ask these activists or people who are proactive in all this, to implement that, and maybe Mrs. Gandhi is the best person to do it. I don't know whether she is right now in power or no, but somebody like her at that level.
Right. You know? I'm dealing with wildlife. I think you come across quite a number of cases with man-animal conflict. Before I move to that topic, I want to ask you your thought process as coming from India. As a country, are we so lost in becoming a developed nation that we are actually forgetting our fellow species? That we are basically being, we are forgetting, we are being ignorant?
It's so sad that I make this statement. I can say this at this point of time because I've traveled the world. I think conservation is... far, far, far ahead. Because we don't know how to value simple things in our lives. We begin with garbage.
Right.
So many animals are dying because of plastic. Don't we all know that? why move ahead? हम तो कोई जाके कोई चीज को बेल्स को या किसी को प्रोटेक्ट तो कर ही नहीं सकते, राइट? नहीं कर सकते. तो अगर एटलीस्ट द ओनली सोशल थिंग दैट यू कैन एक्चुअली बिगिन विद इज टू स्टॉप थ्रोइंग गार्बेज फर्स्ट, बिकॉज दैट इटसेल्फ इज प्रोबेबली गोइंग टू सेव सम बेल और सम शार्क समवेयर इन द ओशन. वी आर नॉट taught basic things in our school, in our education system, with our parents, because littering is supposed to be our birthright. And then we talk about animals coming into our zone, acid throwing, shooing away those animals because you don't want them to be in your territory and you think you own this whole wide world. So why, you know, when you think about all these ecologists and these people who study the ocean, all these people who are actually doing so much work in conservation, why are they only overseas? I'm not saying that they are only overseas, but you hear so much, you see Animal Planet, you see any series in the wildlife, National Geographic, but you'll see most of them abroad, that they are trying to do this conservation in Antarctica or in Amazon. Right. Why is it not there in India? It's first of all, our development is only towards things that I don't know if my reading or is my understanding or my exposure to this is that big. But I don't know how much money we invest in all those things. Our government invests in those things. A small thing, like when I was studying in Australia, there was a small church that I went to, and the way they had conserved and they had made it like a, you know, for foreigners to come and visit that space. It was nothing was there inside. When I went, it was, yeah. And look at our Taj Mahal. I mean, I'm not comparing, but I'm just saying that it is a popular place to visit. But tum jitna paisa ek conservation mein dal sakte ho, apne zoo ko dekho.
Right.
क्या है और उन लोगों के zoos को देखो, दूर क्यों जा रहे हो? You feel suffocated when you go to the zoo. You feel, oh my God, these animals shouldn't be here.
Yes.
Like people like you and me who are aware are saying this. आगे कहाँ जाएं हम लोग? पहले ये तो ठीक करो.
नहीं वही है ना कि हम लोग इतना lost हो गए कि developed nation बनने के लिए. We are so exactly. lost in that factor कि वो सराउंडिंग फैक्टर वी आर फॉरगेटिंग.
अरे डेवलपमेंट में तुम स्काईस्क्रेपर्स बना रहे हो, तुम ब्रिजेस बना रहे हो, तुम फ्लाईओवर्स बना रहे हो, पहले गटर सिस्टम का ख्याल रखो. सब हम लोगों को सब कुछ मालूम है, बट स्टिल इट्स जस्ट हैपनिंग बिकॉज करप्शन. आई डोंट नो व्हाट ऑल इज हैपनिंग. लाइक देयर सो मेनी थिंग्स दैट आर डीप सीटेड हियर, यू नो. आई थिंक इट्स एट दिस स्टेज आई डोंट इवन नो वेयर डू आई बिगिन, व्हाट डू आई टॉक. Because first of all, my knowledge to corruption and all these things, yes, and politics is so zero. Let me just right. say that. But I know somewhere in my heart that we don't have the basic thing for environment. We don't grow up with those values. Because to grow up with those values, the first thing that a child should know is that if I love my environment, I'm not going to litter. And we don't have those basic things with us. How can we move that far? Every smart cookie over here is going abroad. Don't you see? Every family smart ass is sitting in the United States or in, because they are smart people. They want to have quality of life. Yahan kya padha hai tumhari country mein? Chahe tum kitna bhi develop ho jao. But sab log bolte hai na, quality nahi hai. Kyun? Kyunki agar yahan se tumko kahin travel karna pade, तो कितना ट्रैफिक है इन स्पाइट ऑफ द फैक्ट्स दैट आर बीइंग थिंग्स दैट आर क्रिएटेड. सो यू गो टू बेसिक थिंग्स दैट आर नॉट स्ट्रक्चर्ड हियर. वेयर आर वी गोइंग टू थिंक अबाउट एनिमल्स इज सो सो सैड दैट आई एम मेकिंग दिस स्टेटमेंट.
नो, लाइक यू सी सच अ लॉट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोक्यूशन केसेस.
या
सो सच अ लॉट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोक्यूशन केसेस.
सो दिस इज क्रेजी, यू नो. इट्स एंड लेटर्स, राइटिंग लेटर्स टू अथॉरिटीज, एंड आई थिंक द ओनली पर्सन दैट आई राइट really need to talk to looking at the camera, though you told me not to look at the camera, is Mr. Ratan Tata. Because I think that there are so many cable lines that they have. And I think it's not just reaching the right person. There is one in Mulund, which we have videos of. So these monkeys are crossing that electric lines. And they don't know because we are encroached their territories. It's from the forest zone to the city. So we have made those cables. These animals don't know better. They're just crossing the tree. And they are the ones which are getting maximum electrocuted. That's why you have so many cases coming from there. Tata Institute of Social Sciences in Chembur. We have wires there because BARC is there. So everything is connected. They're very close to each other. We have so many electrocuted cases from there. So if the people in power understand, because the monkeys are not going to understand, the people who are constructing are a little more sensitive. Don't we see videos where they show that, oh, Ireland is so sensitive to animals. Oh, this country is so sensitive to animals. They've made special pathways for these migratory birds to go during that time. Can't India be sensitive? At least when you're doing your... Then they'll say, "Arey, jagah hi nahi hai, kahan par banayenge?" Humne letters likhe hain, bakaida letters likhe hain. There is this guy whom I really want to get noticed, is this guy called as Hakim Sheikh. He's an uneducated guy, you know, crass, as crass can be, but huge passion for monkeys. He's the only guy who's able to catch big monkeys. So if anywhere there is a call for big monkeys, Hakim is there. And with his just one intention to save that life, he's been bitten, hospitalized, upteen number of times. But there's that guy is always there and he tells me, "Madam," every time he's doing a rescue, when he got, so Denzel came, we had baby Denzel, which was about, again, 22-day-old baby monkey. Unfortunately, he gave up to his pain and his injuries. He was grade 3 burn, completely down from his chest, hands, legs, rectum, tail, everything gone. And he's like, "Ye same area se hua aur main ab jaake na line tod dunga." Just see the passion that these people have. So, you know, this guy doesn't know better. He's just like trying to say that this is the 100th monkey that they have found there. And every time, wo bolte na jad ko hi nikal do na, kahin to kahan par kaun hamari baat sunega? Agar educated log usko help nahi karenge, या राइट लोग उसको हेल्प नहीं करेंगे तो वो बेचारा कहाँ से, वो तो सिर्फ जाके रेस्क्यू करेगा, मेरे पास लेके आएगा या किसके पास भी जाएगा, हम लोग ठीक करने की कोशिश करेंगे, बट वो तो सफर कर ही रहे हैं ना. एंड हाउ द सेम थिंग वुड हैव हैपेंड टू यू नो सम अदर इम्पॉर्टेंट एनिमल, इकोनॉमिकली इम्पॉर्टेंट एनिमल, वुडंट द गवर्नमेंट हैव सीन इट? बट दीज आर एनिमल्स, दे हैव नो वैल्यू जस्ट लाइक ह्यूमन लाइफ. So it's not paid cognizance too, with the number of letters that we've written, whatever we've done. So human animal, when there is an interaction, this is just one example. We have a golf course in our area. And I think like dozens of birds I have treated for golf injuries. Skulls out, ribs hit, wings dislocated. Makar Sankranti. I can go on and on and on and on. Our festivals are also there to cause agony to them. Look at Diwali. Are we making it a national law? Are we doing something for animals? The Prime Minister also should get some guidelines on animal cruelty. Because unless people from that position don't know what's happening, and they're not, I don't think in their, they have the knowledge that this can, maybe if somebody tells them, I'm sure he's such a sensitive individual that he will do something for them. I'm really sure. But somebody who can approach and tell them that this is important, because Mahatma Gandhi said it, right? That the development of and progress of a nation is determined by the way the animals are treated.
Right.
So we have to, if and consciously, karmic conscious, if you're doing good to the universe is going to do good to you. We all know that. We dwell on it. And we always say, I always say, you know, when I shut my eyes and I tell this to a lot of people, when I'm doing a lot of these animals which are coming in and a lot of money is going in, and you know, day in and day out, like I'm spending thousands of rupees on this wildlife. Somewhere I consciously sit down and I say, hey Bhagwan, mere paas paisa kahan se aayega? Main sara paisa isme dal rahi hu. And then suddenly, somewhere, some good person will come and, you know, Dr. Deepa, I wanted to buy you these medicines for this dog or this monkey you put a post for or this animal that you put a post for. It just happens miraculously. So I don't see any reason why it should not happen if we are progressing towards the right direction. And I think the leaders have to be conscious first. And I'm very sure if Narendra Modi is Mr. Narendra Modi is touched in the right way, he would be able to effectively take out or tweak your laws for animals. Right. You know, especially like Diwali is insane. Makar Sankranti is insane. We are just sitting there to make posts. Ye we rescued, the reporters call us up, and this time we rescued about 25 pigeons and 30 kites. It's suffocating. When you have to amputate that wing and you know that animal is not going to be able to use it, it's like you have to cut off your own hand. It's horrible. I have a barn owl now, which I did. I had kites, which I did. And now they are all in Kalote. I don't know whether I should put them to sleep or whether we should keep them going on. Hmm. Living without that wing. And they're supposed to soar high. It has no end. Reptiles being burnt because people don't have education whether they are poisonous, non-poisonous. I'm not saying nobody is going to, you know, put their life in jeopardy.
Right.
Okay. But sometimes it does help and you don't know which way you can help that animal out. I've had cases in which they've burnt, they've consciously put fire into the holes of those snakes.
And sometimes it's just done for the fun of it.
Yeah, sometimes it's just done for the fun. Because I just want to get a kick off the fact that, oh, I've killed a cobra. It is, and JCBs, the deforestation happening, the, you know, exhuming happening, all man, animal, human contact is creating. How many reptiles? I had to stitch up a cobra's poison gland. I had to, there was a snake that spine was broken.
The one that you did the MRI on.
Yeah. And there are no facilities. No damn facilities. You go to a human hospital for a burn, at least a burn or trauma ka hospital to hoga. Yahan kya hai? You'll be surprised I take them to a human place, incubator. Ekdam quietly I go and do it in one of my friend's centers. And I keep these burnt monkeys over there because they need help. What do we do? My clinic is not going to provide all that kind of facility. I'm not equipped for that. And I can't be spending that kind of money. So, where do we go? What do we do? Whatever we can do from our capacity as veterinarians, we go, we educate, we spend the money, we educate ourselves, we come back to help, and we get zero support. And then we have to, and then when I started the rehab also with Samir, we were lucky. It's his place. He's still offering. I was lucky to find him.
Hmm.
And I was happy that he was interested that all these 8 monkeys that are there now, they're doing so well. Otherwise, we had a monitor lizard that came in egg bounded. She had 21 eggs inside her.
Hmm. No. What does egg bounding mean?
Egg binding means that these animals, they are able to produce eggs like hens,
right,
without being fertile also. So they get egg bound, like tortoises, they get egg bound.
And it's just a genetic thing?
It's not genetic, it's because of metabolic diseases or calcium deficiencies. And was so freaked out scene. We held the animal for 3 months and she got so attached. And I took care of her like a mother to a child, you know, who's really trying to birth. And it took 3 months for her to get the 21 eggs out. She couldn't birth. And then what? We had no place to keep. How many I have more monitors that right now in my clinic. A bicycle went over his neck. So it's crazy. Even this is not a part of our training. And we have to keep, I have to keep begging my experts abroad to help me. If there's a, you know, keep sharing x-rays, CTs of these animals and getting the knowledge to be able to operate on them. A lot of people are doing surgeries now. I've started doing surgeries now.
Right.
We don't know how we are going to help them, but we are trying our best to help them. But we don't have any formal training. Or we can't call ourselves experts just because we are doing this work. But we are trying to help. And we are trying to make a difference in that life. And conserve nature. Because they have wildlife. And then tomorrow they can be left. They are going to balance the ecosystem for us.
I think somewhere, do you think we are forgetting that?
Yeah, we do. That one life, you don't know how it's going to help that ecosystem. That one life. You know, when we release our reptiles and we release the snakes and we release the cobras and we release, I am in so much awe of these boys who rescue them. Wo log bolte na wo hatheli pe jaan leke jaate hain wo log. It's not easy to rescue a cobra or a Russell's viper. I have been bitten by a Russell's viper. I was close to death. So I know that experience, that feeling, because I used to rescue. I stopped after that bite because God saved me from that one bite of a Russell's viper. I could have been dead and gone. So when I see those boys doing it and then they get, I recently had, there was a poison duck that was severed by a JCB machine, and that guy comes to me and he's getting the cobra to me and from all the way from Oran. And I'm just looking at him. I'm like, tujhe dar nahi lagta hai kya? He said, madam, mar jata tha na.
It's passion.
Absolutely. Crazy passion for wildlife. These are the kind of people who should be motivated. They have nothing. They're Swiggy boys, delivery boys, who are doing this in their extra time because they love snakes and they want to do work for snake and monkeys. They don't have proper uniforms. They don't have proper equipments. Kuch nahi hai. My US gayi thi, some of my friends over there, they said, Deepa, how you all are doing the work? Tum log ke paas boots bhi nahi hai. Come, we'll gather. So they gave me some snake sticks, which are, you know, usable. And these guys were so happy when I gave it to them. So this is the kind of things that we are doing, crazy things. मैं सच्ची बोलती हूँ शाबाश है उन लोगों को मैं तो अपने क्लिनिक में वो लोग पाइप में डाल रहे हैं स्नेक और काम कर रही हूँ असली हीरो तो वो हैं उन लोगों की जाके मदद करनी चाहिए कुछ प्रोग्राम्स होने चाहिए ऐसे क्या ऐसे लड़कों को सपोर्ट करके उनको और एजुकेट करो उनको इक्विपमेंट्स दो उनको चीजें दो ताकि वो लोग अपनी जान खतरे में नहीं डाल रहे यू नो इट्स गोइंग टू बी इट्स आई नो दैट अ गाय वाज बिटन ही हैड टू टेक 52 वायल्स ऑफ व्हेन ही गॉट बिटन बाय अ कोबरा एंड ही वाज द ओनली अर्निंग मेंबर ऑफ हिज हाउस आई एम नॉट सेइंग दैट दे आर नॉट स्टूपिड समटाइम्स पैशन इज ओवरड्रिवन बाय एवरीथिंग आई नो दैट क्रेज करना है मतलब करना है रेस्क्यू वो सोचते नहीं है यंग लड़के होते हैं सो बट आई एम सेइंग दैट ही वाज वेरी लकी टू सर्वाइव ही लॉस्ट अ थंब आल्सो एन इंडेक्स फिंगर एंड अ थंब बट ही सर्वाइव फॉर्चुनेटली एंड ही स्टिल गोज फॉर रेस्क्यूज इतने पागल पागलपंथी के हद तक होते हैं ऐसे लोगों को यू शुड एक्चुअली यू नो ट्राई टू हेल्प हैव ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस दैट ट्राई टू हेल्प दीस काइंड ऑफ इंडिविजुअल्स दे आर फैमिलीज बिकॉज कल को अगर वो मर जाए तो कौन करेगा बट दैट्स अ सैड स्टोरी एंड बट इट्स अ ट्रूथ इन एवरी वेयर यू हैव सो मेनी विक्टिम्स देयर एंड सो मेनी पीपल वी आर सिटिंग इन नाइस फैंसी प्लेसेस एंड टॉकिंग हियर एंड देयर समबडी इज एक्चुअली स्ट्रगलिंग फॉर एन एनिमल व्हिच इज सो ट्रू इट हैपेंस ऑल द टाइम राइट बट वी आर डूइंग आवर बिट आल्सो
My last question to you here is, are we fighting a battle that has been lost long time ago?
At least we are fighting. Right?
Right.
We've not given up. And we won't. People who come with the spirit on earth have an unending battle. Tell me, Pooja, I ask you this question. If you were not working with dogs and if you were not working with animals, what you would be doing? I'm asking you a question.
I don't think so. I wouldn't be doing anything else. Yeah.
See?
This is what my calling has been.
See?
Yes.
How it is? You have come to fight your own battle, right? And you're doing welfare work in your own way, which is helping so many animals. And somewhere you're winning, right? Somewhere in right. your space, you're winning this right. battle over what it was an existing battle in the past.
Yes.
You have accomplished, that's why you're here. I have won so many battles. I have saved lives. Yes. You have saved lives in your own way. We have made a difference. We are winning. And there'll be so many like us created. You know, so many people who are going to do this work, be with animals, help animals. And I think people like us somewhere are going to bring that balance. And we are bringing a balance. And we are teaching the new generation to coexist in a better way by the way we can, to the best of our abilities. I think that's the way I look at it. And I never say die. I always have to move on. Even tomorrow, to my last dying breath, if it has as cliche or as stupid as it may sound or as filmy as it may sound, I am going to be working for animal welfare in my own way, whether good, right, bad or the other. But I know that this is my calling to my last breath. So I'm there to do it.
Thank you, Deepa. It was wonderful having you here today.
Thank you so much. I hope I didn't bore you.
Not at all. It was amazing.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
You're most welcome. Yeah. Most welcome.